The heifer. In the name of God, the most gracious, the most merciful. Alif Lam Mim. This is the book, there is no doubt in it. It is a guide for those who are mindful of God, who believe in the unseen and are steadfast in prayer, and spend out of what we have provided them with. Those who believe in the revelation sent down to you and what was sent down before you, and firmly believe in the life to come. They are the people who are rightly following their Lord, and it is they who shall be successful. As for those who are bent on denying the truth, it makes no difference to them whether you warn them or not. They will not believe. God has set a seal on their hearts and their ears, and over their eyes there is a covering. They will have a terrible punishment. There are some who say, "We believe in God in the last day," yet they are not believers. They seek to deceive God and the believers, but they only deceive themselves, though they do not realize it. In their hearts is a disease which God has increased. They will have a painful punishment because they have been lying. When they are told, "Do not cause corruption in the land," they say, "We are only promoters of peace." But it is they who are really causing corruption, though they do not realize it. And when they are told, "Believe as other people have believed," they say, "Are we to believe just as fools believe?" Surely they are the fools, even though they do not realize it. When they meet those who believe, they say, "We believe." But when they are alone with their evil leaders, they say, "We are really with you. We were only mocking." God will requite them for their mockery and draw them on for a while to wander blindly in their insolence. Such are those who have taken misguidance in exchange for guidance, but their bargain does not profit them, nor have they found true guidance. They are like those who kindled a fire, and when it lighted up all around them, God took away their sight and left them in utter darkness, unable to see, deaf, dumb, and blind. They will never return to the right path. Or their case is like that of a heavy rain pouring down from the clouds, accompanied by darkness, thunder, and lightning. They thrust their fingers in their ears at the sound of the thunderclaps for fear of death. God thus encompasses those who deny the truth. The lightning almost takes away their sight. Whenever it flashes upon them, they walk on, but as soon as the darkness falls around them, they stand still. Indeed, if God pleased, he could take away their hearing and their sight. God has power over all things. People, worship your Lord who created you and those before you so that you may become righteous, who made the earth a bed and the sky a canopy, and it is he who sends down rain from above for the growth of every kind of food, for your sustenance. And do not knowingly set up rivals to God. If you are in doubt about the revelation we have sent down to our servant, then produce a single chapter like it, and call upon your helpers besides God if you are truthful. But if you cannot do it, and you can never do it, then guard yourselves against the fire whose fuel is men and stones, prepared for those who deny the truth. Give the good news to those who believe and do good works, that they will have gardens through which rivers flow. Whenever they are given fruit to eat, they will say, "This is what we were provided with before," because they were given similar things, and there will be pure spouses for them, and they will abide there forever. God does not disdain to give a parable about a gnat or a smaller creature. The faithful know that it is the truth from their Lord, but those who deny the truth ask, "What could God mean by this parable?" He lets many go astray through it, and he guides many by it. But he makes only the disobedient go astray, those who break God's covenant after they have pledged to keep it, and sever whatever God has ordered to be joined, and spread corruption in the land. It is they who are the losers. How can you disbelieve in God when you are dead, lifeless, and he gave you life? He will let you die once more and bring you back to life again, whereupon you will be returned to him. It is he who created everything on the earth for you. Then he turned towards heaven and fashioned it into the seven heavens. He has knowledge of all things. When your Lord said to the angels, "I am putting a successor on earth," they said, "Will you place someone there who will cause corruption on it and shed blood?" while we glorify you with your praise and extol your holiness, God answered, "Surely I know that which you do not know." He taught Adam all the names. Then he set them before the angels and said, "Tell me the names of these, if what you say be true." They said, "Glory be to you. We have no knowledge except whatever you have taught us. You are the all-knowing, the all-wise." Then he said, "O Adam, tell them their names." When Adam had told them the names, God said to the angels, "Did I not say to you, I know the secrets of the heavens and of the earth, and I know what you reveal and what you conceal?" When we said to the angels, "Bow down before Adam," they all bowed down except for Iblis, Satan. He refused and acted proudly and became an unbeliever. We said, "O Adam, live with your wife in paradise and eat freely from it anywhere you may wish. Yet do not approach this tree lest you become wrongdoers." But Satan caused them both to slip through this and thus brought about the loss of their former state. We said, "Go down from here as enemies to each other, and on earth you shall have your abode and your livelihood for a while." Then Adam received some words of prayer from his Lord, and he accepted his repentance. He is the forgiving one, the merciful. We said, "Go down, all of you, from here. Then when guidance comes to you from me, anyone who follows my guidance will have no fear, nor will they grieve. Those who deny and reject our sign shall be the inhabitants of the fire. Therein shall they abide forever." Children of Israel, remember the favors I have bestowed upon you, and fulfill the covenant that you made with me. I shall fulfill the covenant I made with you. Fear me alone, and believe in the message I have sent down, which fulfills that predictions about the last prophet in their scripture, which you already possess, and do not be foremost among those who deny its truth. Do not sell my revelations for a paltry price. Fear me alone. Do not mix truth with falsehood, or hide the truth when you know it. Attend to your prayers, give the zakat, the prescribed alms, and bow down with those who bow down. Do you admonish others to do good and forget this yourselves, yet you read the book? Will you not then understand? Seek help with patience and prayer. This is indeed an exacting discipline, but not to the humble, who know for certain that they will meet their Lord and that they will return to him. Children of Israel, remember my blessings which I have bestowed on you, and how I favored you above all other people. Guard yourselves against a day on which no soul shall in the least avail another, when neither intercession nor ransom shall be accepted from it, nor shall help be given to it. Remember when we delivered you from Pharaoh's people who subjected you to grievous torment, slaying your sons and sparing only your daughters. Surely in that there was a great trial for you from your Lord. And when we divided the sea for you and saved you and drowned Pharaoh's people while you looked on, we appointed for Moses 40 nights on Mount Sinai. And in his absence you took to worshipping the calf and thus became transgressors. Yet after that we pardoned you, so that you might be grateful. Remember when we gave Moses the scripture and the criterion to distinguish between right and wrong, so that you might be guided. When Moses said to his people, "O my people, you have indeed wronged yourselves by worshipping the calf. Turn in repentance to your Creator, and slay the culprits among you. That course is best for you in the sight of your Maker. He relented towards you. He is the forgiving one, the merciful." Remember when you said, "Moses, we will not believe in you until we see God with our own eyes." A thunderbolt struck you while you were looking on. Then we brought you back to life after your death, so that you might be grateful. Then we caused the clouds to provide shade for you, and sent down for you manna and quail, saying, "Eat the good things we have provided for you." Indeed, they did not wrong us, but they wronged themselves. Remember when we said, "Enter this land and eat freely wherever you will. Make your way through the gates, bowing down and saying, 'God, forgive us our sins.' We shall forgive you your sins, and we shall give abundance to those who do good. But the wrongdoers changed the words to something other than what they had been told. So we sent down upon the transgressors a punishment from heaven, because they were disobedient. When Moses prayed for water for his people, we said to him, "Strike the rock with your staff." And there gushed out from it 12 springs. Each tribe knew its drinking place. We said, "Eat and drink what God has provided, and do not act wrongfully in the land, spreading corruption." When you said, "Moses, we cannot bear to eat only one kind of food, so pray to your Lord to bring forth for us some of the earth's produce, its herbs and cucumbers, its garlics, lentils, and onions," Moses said, "Would you take a lesser thing in exchange for what is better? Go to some town, and there you will find all that you demand." Abasement and destitution were stamped upon them, and they incurred the wrath of God for having rejected his signs, and they killed his prophets unjustly, because they were rebels and transgressors. The believers, the Jews, the Christians, and the Sabians, all those who believe in God in the last day and do good deeds, will be rewarded by their Lord. They shall have no fear, nor shall they grieve. Children of Israel, we made a covenant with you and raised the mountain high above you, saying, "Hold fast to what we have given you, and bear its contents in mind, so that you may guard yourselves against evil." Yet after that you turned away, and but for God's grace and mercy, you would have surely been among the losers. You are aware of those who transgressed in the matter of the Sabbath, whereupon we said to them, "Be as apes despised." We made their fate an example to their own generation, and to those who followed them, and a lesson to those who fear God. When Moses said to his people, "God commands you to sacrifice a heifer," they said, "Are you making a mockery of us?" We answered, "God forbid that I should be so ignorant." They said, "Ask your Lord to make it clear to us what sort of heifer she should be." He answered, "God says she should be neither too old nor too young, but in between. So do as you are commanded." They said, "Call on your Lord for us to show us what color she should be." He answered, "God says she should be a bright yellow heifer, pleasing to the eye." They said, "Ask your Lord to make it clear to us the exact type of heifer she should be, for to us all heifers look alike. If God wills, we shall be rightly guided." Moses answered, "Your Lord says she should be a heifer which has not been yoked to plow the land or water the fields, a heifer free from any blemish." "Now you have told us the truth," they answered, and they sacrificed it, though they would rather not have done it. Then, when you Israelites killed someone and started to blame one another, God brought to light what you concealed. We said, "Strike the corpse with a part of it." Thus God restores the dead to life and shows you his signs, so that you may understand. Then your hearts became as hard as rock, or even harder. For there are rocks from which streams gush forth, and there are some that cleave asunder and water flows out from them, while others fall down for fear of God. God is not unaware of what you do. Do you then hope that they will believe in you when some of them have already heard the word of God, and then, after having understood it, they knowingly perverted it? When they meet the faithful, they say, "We are believers." But when alone, they say to each other, "Must you tell them what God has revealed to us?" They will only use it to argue against you before your Lord. Have you no sense? Do they not know that God knows all that they conceal and all that they disclose? There are among them unlettered people who have no real knowledge of the Scriptures, knowing only their own wishful thinking and following only conjecture. Woe to those who write the Scripture with their own hands and then declare, "This is from God," in order to sell it for a paltry price. Woe to them because of what their own hands have written, and woe to them for what they have earned. They say, "The fire is not going to touch us, and even if it does, it will only be for a few days." Say to them, "Have you received a promise from God? For God never breaks his promise. Or do you attribute something to God which you do not know? Truly, those who do evil and are encompassed by their misdeeds shall be the inmates of the fire. Therein they shall abide forever. But those who believe and do good works are the heirs of paradise. There they shall abide forever. Remember when we made a covenant with the children of Israel. Worship none but God and be good to your parents and to relatives and orphans and the needy. And speak kindly to people. Attend to your prayers and pay the zakat, prescribed alms. But with the exception of a few, you turned away, in aversion, and paid no heed. When we made a covenant with you, we said, you shall not shed each other's blood, nor turn your people out of their homes. You consented to this and bore witness. Yet here you are, slaying one another and driving some of your own people from their homelands, aiding one another against them, committing sin and aggression. But if they came to you as captives, you would ransom them. Surely their very expulsion was unlawful for you. Do you believe in one part of the book and deny another part of it? Those of you who act thus shall be rewarded with disgrace in this world and with a severe punishment on the day of resurrection. God is never unaware of what you do. Such are they who buy the life of this world at the price of the hereafter. Their punishment shall not be lightened for them, nor shall they be helped. To Moses we gave the book and sent a succession of messengers after him. We gave Jesus, son of Mary, clear signs and strengthened him with the Holy Spirit. But whenever a messenger came to you with something which you did not desire, you grew arrogant, calling some liars and slaying others. They say, our hearts are impenetrably wrapped against whatever you say. But God has rejected them for their denial. They have but little faith. And now that a book has come to them from God, fulfilling that, predictions about the final prophet in their scriptures, which is with them, they deny it. Whereas previously, they used to pray for victory against the disbelievers. Yet when there came to them that which they recognized as the truth, they rejected it. God's rejection is the due of all who deny the truth. What they have sold their souls for is evil. To the denial of God's own revelation, grudging that he should reveal his bounty to whom he chooses from among his servants, they have incurred wrath upon wrath. Humiliating punishment awaits those who deny the truth. When they are told, believe in what God has revealed, they say, we believe in what was revealed to us, while they deny the truth in what has been sent down after that, even though it is the truth, confirming that which they already have. Say, what, did you kill God's prophets in the past, if we were true believers? Moses came to you with clear signs, but in his absence you worshipped a calf and became wrongdoers. When we made a covenant with you and raised the mountain above you, saying, hold firmly to what we have given you and listen, you said, we hear, but we disobey. And their hearts were filled with the love of the calf because of their refusal to acknowledge the truth. Say, evil is that to which your faith enjoins you, if you are indeed believers. Say, if God's abode of the hereafter is for you alone, to the exclusion of all others, then wish for death, if you are truthful. But they will never wish for death, because of what their own hands have sent on before them. God is fully aware of the wrongdoers. You will find them clinging to life more eagerly than any other people, even the polytheist. Any of them would wish to be given a life of 1,000 years, though even such a long life would not save them from our punishment, and God sees all that they do. Say, anyone who is an enemy of Gabriel, who by God's leave has brought down to your heart the Quran, fulfilling that predictions about the last prophet in the earlier revelations, which precedes it, and is a guidance and good news for the faithful. Whoever is an enemy of God, his angels or his messengers or of Gabriel or Michael, will surely find that God too is the enemy of those who deny the truth. We have sent down clear signs to you, and no one will reject them except the wicked. Why is it that whenever they make a covenant, some of them cast it aside? Most of them do not believe. They pursued what the devils falsely attributed to the kingdom of Solomon. Solomon was not an unbeliever. It is the devils who are unbelievers. They taught people witchcraft and that which was sent down to Harut and Marut, the two angels in Babylon. But these two taught no one until they had said, "We are but a trial, therefore do not disbelieve in God's guidance." So men learnt from them that by which they caused discord between man and wife, but they harmed no one thereby except by the command of God. On the contrary, these people learned that which would harm them and do them no good, knowing full well that whoever acquired this knowledge would have no share in the hereafter. Evil indeed was the price for which they sold their souls, if only they had known it. And had they but believed and been mindful of God, his reward would have been far better for them if they had but known it. Believers, do not say to the prophet Raina, but say Unzurna, and listen to him with attention. For those who deny the truth, there is a painful punishment. They who deny the truth from among the people of the book, or from among those who associate partners with God, do not desire that any good should be sent down to you from your Lord. But God singles out for his grace whom he wills, for God is limitless in his great bounty. If we abrogate a verse or cause it to be forgotten, we will replace it by a better one, or one similar to it. Do you not know that God has power over all things? Do you not know the kingdom of the heavens and the earth belongs to God alone, and that there is no protector or helper for you besides God? Do you all want to question your messenger just as Moses was questioned previously? Anyone who exchanges faith for unbelief has strayed far from the right path. Many among the people of the book wish, through envy, to lead you back to unbelief now that you have embraced the faith and the truth has been made plain to them. But you should pardon them and bear with them until God gives his command. Truly, God has power over all things. Attend to your prayers and pay the prescribed alms. Any good you store up for yourselves, you will find it with God. Certainly God sees what you do. They declare, "None shall ever enter heaven unless he be a Jew or a Christian." This is their own wishful thinking. Prophet, say, produce your evidence if you are telling the truth. Indeed, those who submit themselves to God and act righteously shall be rewarded by their Lord. They shall have no fear, nor shall they grieve. The Jews say the Christians have no ground to stand on, and the Christians say the Jews have no ground to stand on. Yet they both recite the book, and those who have no knowledge say the same. God will judge between them on the day of resurrection concerning their disputes. Who could be more wicked than someone who prevents God's name from being mentioned in his places of worship and seeks to bring about their ruin, while it behooves these men to enter them with fear in their hearts? There is disgrace in store for them in this world, and a great punishment in the next. The east and the west belong to God. Whichever way you turn, there is the face of God. God is all-pervading and all-knowing. They say, "God has taken a son." Glory be to him. Everything in the heavens and the earth belongs to him. All things are obedient to him. He is the originator of the heavens and the earth, and when he decrees something, he says only, "Be," and it is. Those who are devoid of knowledge say, "Why does God not speak to us or show us a sign?" The same demand was made by those before them. Their hearts are all alike. "We have made the signs clear to those whose faith is firm. We have sent you with the truth, bearing good news and giving warning. You will not be held accountable for the people of the fire." Neither the Christians nor the Jews will be pleased with you until you follow their ways. Say, "God's guidance is the only true guidance." If you follow their desires after the knowledge which has come to you, you would not have any patron or supporter against God. Those whom we have given this book follow it as it ought to be followed. It is they who truly believe in it. Those who deny it will be the losers. Children of Israel, remember my favor which I have bestowed upon you, and how I preferred you above all other people, and fear a day when no human being shall avail another, nor shall ransom be accepted from any of them, nor shall intercession be of any use to them, and none shall be succored. When his Lord tested Abraham with certain commands, and he fulfilled them, he said, I will make you a leader of men. Abraham asked, And what of my descendants? He answered, My covenant does not extend to the transgressors. And we made the house, the Kaaba, a place of assembly and a sanctuary for mankind, saying, Make the place where Abraham stood a place of worship. We commanded Abraham and Ismail, Purify my house for those who walk around it, those who stay there for devotion, and those who bow down and prostrate themselves. And when Abraham prayed, My Lord, make this city a city of peace, and provide its inhabitants with fruits, such of them as believe in God in the last day. God said, As for those who deny the truth, I will grant them benefits for a short while, and then subject them to the punishment of the fire, an evil destination. And when Abraham and Ishmael were laying the foundation of the house, they prayed, Our Lord, accept this from us, for you are all-hearing, all-knowing. Lord, make us submissive to you. Make our descendants a nation that will submit to you. Teach us our rites of worship and turn to us with mercy. You are the forgiving one, the merciful. Our Lord, send forth to them a messenger of their own to recite your revelations to them, to teach them the scripture and wisdom and purify them. You are the mighty, the wise one. Who but a foolish man would turn away from the religion of Abraham? We chose him in this world, and in the hereafter he shall be among the righteous. When his Lord said to him, Surrender, he responded, I have surrendered to the Lord of the universe. And Abraham enjoined his sons to do the same, as did Jacob. My sons, God has chosen this religion for you, so do not let death overtake you, except when you are in a state of submission. Were you present when Jacob faced the hour of death? And he asked his sons, Who will you worship after me? They answered, We will worship your God, and the God of your fathers, Abraham and Ishmael and Isaac, the one God. We have submitted ourselves to him. Those were a people that have passed away. What they did is theirs, and what you have done is yours. You will not be answerable for their deeds. They say, Be Jews or Christians, and you shall be rightly guided. Say, By no means. We believe in the faith of Abraham, who was ever inclined to God. He was not one of those who set up partners with God. Say, We believe in God and what was revealed to us and what was revealed to Abraham, Ishmael, Isaac, Jacob, and their descendants, and what was given to Moses and Jesus, and what was given to the other prophets by their Lord. We make no distinction between any of them. It is to him that we surrender ourselves. If they believe as you have believed, then they are rightly guided. But if they turn back, then know that they are entrenched in hostility. God will surely suffice to defend you against them, for he is all-hearing, all-knowing. We take on God's own die. Who has a better die than God's? We worship him alone. Say, Do you dispute with us about God, while he is our Lord and your Lord? We have our actions and you have your actions. We are devoted to him alone. Do you claim that Abraham and Ishmael and Isaac and Jacob and their descendants were all Jews or Christians? Say, Do you know better or does God? And who could be more unjust than one who conceals a testimony given to him by God? God is not unaware of what you do. Those were a people that have passed away. Theirs is what they did and yours is what you have done. You shall not be answerable for their deeds. The foolish will ask, What has made them turn away from their direction of prayer which they used to face? Say, the east and the west belong to God. He guides whom he pleases to the right path. Thus we have made you a middle nation, so that you may act as witnesses for mankind, and the messenger may be a witness for you. We decreed your former prayer direction towards which you used to face only in order that we might make a clear distinction between the messenger's true followers and those who were to turn their backs on him. This was indeed a hard test for all but those whom God has guided. God will never let your faith go to waste. God is compassionate and merciful to mankind. We have frequently seen you turn your face towards heaven, so we will make you turn in a direction for prayer that would please you. So turn your face now towards the sacred mosque, and wherever you may be, turn your face towards it. Those who were given the book know this to be the truth from their Lord. God is not unaware of what they do. But even if you should produce every kind of sign for those who have been given the book, they would never accept your prayer direction. Nor would you accept their prayer direction. Nor would any of them accept one another's direction. If after all the knowledge you have been given, you yield to their desires, then you shall surely become a transgressor. Those to whom we have given the book recognize it just as they recognize their own sons, but some of them knowingly conceal the truth. Truth is what comes from your Lord. Therefore, do not be of those who doubt. Each community has its own direction in which it turns. Vie then with one another in doing good works. Wherever you may be, God will bring you all before him. God has power over all things. Wherever you set out from, turn your face in the direction of the sacred mosque. This is the truth from your Lord. He is not unaware of what you do. Wherever you come from, turn your face to the sacred mosque. Wherever you may be, turn your faces towards it, so that people will not have any argument against you, except for the wrongdoers among them. Do not fear them, fear me, so that I may perfect my favor to you, and you may be rightly guided. Thus we have sent among you a messenger of your own to recite our revelations to you, purify you, and teach you the book and wisdom, and to teach you what you did not know. So remember me. I will remember you. Be thankful to me, and do not be ungrateful. You who believe, seek help through patience and prayer. Surely God is with the steadfast. Do not say that those who are killed in God's cause are dead. They are alive, but you are not aware of it. We shall certainly test you with fear and hunger and loss of property, lives, and crops. Give good news to those who endure with fortitude. Those who say, when afflicted with a calamity, we belong to God, and to him we shall return, are the ones who will have blessings and mercy from their Lord. It is they who are on the right path. Safa and Marwa are among the symbols set up by God. There is nothing wrong if anyone goes on a pilgrimage to the house or performs a minor pilgrimage in walking to and fro between them. Of anyone who does good of his own accord, God is appreciative and aware. Those who conceal the evidence of the truth and the guidance we have revealed, after we have made them clear to the people in the scripture, will be rejected by God, and so do others. But from those who repent and mend their ways and make known the truth, I will certainly accept their repentance. I am the ever-relenting, the most merciful. Those who deny the truth and die as deniers, on them shall be the curse of God and of angels and of men altogether. Under it they shall remain forever. Their punishment shall not be lightened, nor shall they be granted respite. Your God is one God. There is no deity save him. He is the compassionate, the merciful. In the creation of the heavens and the earth, in the alternation of night and day, in the ships that sail the ocean bearing cargoes beneficial to man, in the water which God sends down from the sky and with which he revives the earth after its death, scattering over it all kinds of animals, in the courses of the winds, and in the clouds pressed into service between earth and sky. There are indeed signs for people who use their reason. Yet there are some who set up equals with God, and adore them with the adoration due to God. But those who believe love God most. If only the wrongdoers could see, as they will see when they face the punishment, that all power belongs to God, and that God is severe in punishment. When they face their punishment, those who have been followed will disown their followers, and all their ties shall be cut asunder. Those who followed will say, "If we could only return to the world, we would disown them as they have disowned us." God will thus show them their actions as a cause of bitter regret and remorse. They shall never emerge from the fire. O mankind, eat whatever is lawful and wholesome on the earth, and do not follow the footsteps of Satan, for he is indeed your avowed enemy. He bids you only to do evil and to commit deeds of abomination and to attribute to God something of which you have no knowledge. But when they are told, "Follow what God has sent down," they answer, "We will follow the ways of our fathers," even though their fathers did not use their reason and were devoid of all guidance. Those who deny the truth are like animals, which hear nothing in your call but the sound of a voice, without understanding its meaning. They are deaf, dumb, and blind. They understand nothing. Believers, eat the wholesome things which we have provided for you and give thanks to God, if it is Him you worship. He has forbidden you only carrion, blood, and the flesh of swine, also any flesh that is consecrated other than in the name of God. But for one who is driven by necessity, neither craving nor transgressing, it is no sin, for God is forgiving and merciful. Those who conceal any part of the scriptures which God has revealed in order to gain some paltry end simply fill their bellies with fire. On the day of resurrection, God will neither speak to them nor purify them. They will have a painful punishment. Those are the ones who have taken error in exchange for guidance and punishment for forgiveness. How little do they seem to fear the fire? That is because God has sent down the book with the truth, and those who pursue differences in the scriptures go much too far in dissension. Virtue does not consist in whether you face towards the east or the west. Virtue means believing in God, the last day, the angels, the book, and the prophets. The virtuous are those who, despite their love for it, give away their wealth to their relatives, to orphans, and to the very poor, and to travelers and those who ask for charity, and to set slaves free, and who attend their prayers and pay the alms, and who keep their pledges when they make them, and show patience in hardship and adversity and in times of distress. Such are the true believers, and such are the God-fearing. Believers, retribution is prescribed for you in cases of murder. The free man for the free man, the slave for the slave, the female for the female. If the offender is granted some remission by the heir of the slain person, the agreed penalty should be equitably exacted and should be discharged in a handsome manner. This is an alleviation from your Lord and an act of grace. He who transgresses after this shall have a painful punishment. In this law of retribution there is life for you, O people of understanding, so that perhaps you will be mindful of God. It is prescribed that when death approaches any of you, and he is leaving behind wealth, he shall make a will in favor of his parents and relatives equitably. This is a duty for all who fear God. Anyone who alters it, once he has heard it, shall be accountable for his crime. Surely God is all-hearing and all-knowing. But if anyone apprehends partiality or an injustice on the part of a testator, it shall be no sin for him to bring about a settlement between the parties. God is forgiving and merciful. Believers, fasting has been prescribed for you just as it was prescribed for those before you, so that you may guard yourselves against evil. Fast for a specified number of days, But if anyone among you is ill or on a journey, let him fast the same number of days later. For those who can fast only with extreme difficulty, there is a way to compensate: the feeding of a needy person. But he who does good of his own accord shall be well rewarded. But to fast is better for you, if you only knew. The month of Ramadan is the month when the Quran was sent down as a guidance for mankind, with clear proofs of guidance and the criterion by which to distinguish right from wrong. Therefore, whoever of you is present in that month, let him fast. But he who is ill or on a journey shall fast a similar number of days later on. God desires ease for you, not hardship. He desires you to fast the whole month, so that you may glorify him for his having guided you, and so that you may be grateful to him. When my servants ask you about me, say that I am near. I respond to the call of one who calls whenever he calls to me. Let them then respond to me and believe in me, so that they may be rightly guided. It has been made lawful for you to go to your wives on the night of the fast. They are like a garment for you, and you are like a garment for them. God is aware that you are deceiving yourselves, and he has turned in mercy towards you and pardoned you. So you may now consort with them and seek what God has ordained for you. Eat and drink until the white thread of dawn becomes distinct from the black. Then resume the fast until nightfall, and do not approach them during the nights of your devotional retreat in the mosque. These are the limits set by God, so do not approach them. Thus he makes clear his commandments to mankind, so that they may guard themselves against evil. Do not consume one another's property by unjust means, nor offer it as a bribe to the authorities, so that you may deliberately and wrongfully devour a part of other people's wealth. They ask you about the phases of the moon. Say they are a means of determining time, for the regulation of people's affairs, and for the pilgrimage. Piety does not consist of entering your houses from the rear. Indeed, one who guards himself against evil out of fear of God is the truly righteous one. Enter your houses by the doors and be mindful of God, so that you may prosper. And fight in God's cause against those who wage war against you. But do not commit aggression, for surely God does not love aggressors. Slay them wherever you find them, those who fight against you. Drive them out of the places from which they drove you, for religious persecution is worse than killing. Do not fight them at the sacred mosque unless they fight you there. If they do fight you, slay them. Such is the reward for those who deny the truth. But if they desist, then surely God is most forgiving and merciful. Fight them until there is no more fitna, religious persecution, and religion belongs to God alone. If they desist, then let there be no hostility, except towards aggressors. A sacred month for a sacred month. Violation of sanctity calls for fair retribution. Thus you may exact retribution from whoever transgresses against you, in proportion to his transgression. Fear God, and know that God is with those who are mindful of him. Spend for God's cause. Do not cast yourselves into destruction by your own hands. Do good. God loves the doers of good. Perform the Hajj and the minor pilgrimage, Umrah, for the sake of God. If you are prevented from doing so, then make whatever offering you can afford and do not shave your heads until the offering has reached the place of sacrifice. But if any of you is ill or has an ailment of the head, he should compensate by fasting or almsgiving or sacrifice. In times of peace, if any of you combines the minor pilgrimage with the Hajj, he should make whatever offering he can afford, but if he lacks the means, then let him fast 3 days during the pilgrimage and for 7 days after his return. That is 10 days in all. That is incumbent upon anyone whose family does not live near the sacred mosque. Fear God, and know that God is severe in punishment. The pilgrimage is in the appointed months. Whoever intends to perform it during them must abstain from indecent speech, from all wicked conduct, and from quarreling while on the pilgrimage. Whatever good you may do, God is aware of it. Make provision for yourselves, but surely the best of all provision is God consciousness. Always be mindful of me, you that are endowed with understanding. You will be committing no sin if during the pilgrimage you seek to obtain any bounty from your Lord. When you return from Arafat, remember God at the sacred place, and remember him as he has guided you. Before this, you are surely astray. Then press on from where the pilgrims stream forth and ask God's forgiveness. God is ever forgiving, most merciful. When you have performed the acts of worship prescribed for you, celebrate the praises of God as you celebrated the praises of your fathers, and even more fervently than that. There are some who say, "Our Lord, give us the abundance in this world." These shall have no share in the world to come. But there are others who pray, "Our Lord, grant us good in this world as well as good in the world to come, and protect us from the torment of the fire." They shall have a good share from what they have earned. God is swift in his reckoning. Remember God during the appointed days, for one who hastens to leave in 2 days, it shall be no sin. And for one who stays on, it shall be no sin for him either. This is for one who fears God. Have fear of God, and know that you shall all be gathered before him. There are some men whose views on the affairs of this life may please you. They even call on God to witness whatever is in their heart, yet they are the most contentious of quarrelers. When he turns away, he sets out to spread corruption in the land, destroying crops and cattle. God does not love corruption. When he is told, "Have fear of God," he is seized by pride, which drives him to wrongdoing. Hell shall be enough for him, a dreadful resting place. But there are others who would dedicate themselves to seeking the pleasure of God. God is compassionate to his servants. Believers, surrender yourselves totally to God, and do not follow in the footsteps of Satan. Surely he is your sworn enemy. But if you lapse after the clear signs that have come to you, then know that God is mighty and wise. Are they only waiting for God as well as the angels to come down to them under canopies of clouds, so that the matter will be settled? All things return to God. Ask the children of Israel how many clear signs we have given them. Anyone who changes God's blessing, once it has come to him, will find God is stern in punishment. The life of this world is made to appear attractive for those who deny the truth, and they scoff at those who believe. But those who fear God shall be above them on the day of resurrection. God bestows his bounties on whoever he pleases without stinting. Mankind was once a single community, but then people developed differences. So God sent prophets to them as bearers of good tidings and warning, and sent down with them the book containing the truth, so that he might judge between their disputes. It was only those to whom it, the scripture, was given who disagreed about it after clear signs had come to them, because of a rivalry between them. God, by his will, guided the believers to the truth about which the others had disputed. God guides whom he will to a straight path. Do you think that you will enter paradise without having suffered like those who passed away before you? Affliction and hardship befell them, and so shaken were they that the messenger and the believers with him would exclaim, "When will God's help come? Surely the help of God is near." They will ask you what they should spend on others. Say, "Whatever you give should be for parents, close relatives, orphans, the needy, and travelers. God is well aware of whatever good you do. Fighting in defense is ordained for you, abhorrent as it may be to you. You may dislike something although it is good for you, or like something although it is bad for you. God knows, but you do not." They ask you about fighting in the sacred month. Say, to fight in a sacred month is a grave matter. But barring people from the path of God, to deny him and expelling people from the sacred mosque, are far graver in his sight. and persecution is worse than killing. They will not stop fighting you until they make you renounce your faith, if they can. Whoever of you turns back from his faith and dies as a denier of the truth will have his deeds come to nothing in this world and the hereafter, and he will be an inhabitant of the fire to abide therein forever. But those who have believed, migrated, and striven for God's cause can look forward to God's mercy. God is forgiving and merciful. They ask you, Prophet, about intoxicants and gambling. Say there is great sin in both, although they have some benefit for people. But their harm is greater than their benefit. They ask you what they should spend in God's cause. Say, whatever is surplus to your needs. Thus God makes his commandments clear to you so that you may reflect upon this world and the hereafter. They ask you about orphans. Say, promotion of their welfare is an act of great goodness. There is no harm in your living together with them, for they are your brothers. God knows the mischief maker from the reformer. If God had so willed, he could have afflicted you with hardship. Surely God is mighty and wise. Do not marry women who associate partners with God until they believe. A believing bondwoman is better than a woman who associates partners with God, however pleasing she may appear to you. Nor give believing women in marriage to men who associate partners with God till they have believed. A believing bondman is certainly better than a man who associates partners with God, even though he may please you. Such people call you to hellfire, but God calls you to paradise and to forgiveness. He makes his messages clear to people, so that they might bear them in mind. They ask you about menstruation. Say, it is an impurity, so keep away from women during it, and do not approach them until they are cleansed. When they are cleansed, you may approach them as God has ordained. God loves those who turn to him in penitence, and he loves those who keep themselves clean. Your wives are your fields. Go, then, into your fields as you will. Do good deeds and fear God, and know that you shall meet him. Give good tidings to the believers. Do not make God a pretext when you swear by him to avoid doing good, being righteous, and making peace between people. God is all-hearing and all-knowing. God will not call you to account for any oaths you uttered unintentionally, but he will take you to task for what is intended in your hearts. God is most forgiving and forbearing. For those who swear that they will not approach their wives, there shall be a waiting period of 4 months. If they revert to conciliation, surely God is most forgiving and ever merciful. But if they decide upon divorce, God is all-hearing and all-knowing. Divorced women should wait for 3 menstrual cycles. It is unlawful for them, if they believe in God in the last day, to hide what God has created in their wombs. Their husbands have the right to take them back within that time, if they desire to be reconciled. The wives have rights corresponding to those which the husbands have, according to what is recognized to be fair. But men have a rank above them. God is almighty, all-wise. Divorce may be pronounced twice, and then a woman must be retained honorably or released with kindness. It is not lawful for you to take away anything of what you have given your wives, unless both fear that they should not be able to observe the bounds set by God. In such a case, it shall be no sin for either of them if the woman opts to give something for her release. These are the bounds set by God. Do not transgress them. Those who transgress the bounds of God are wrongdoers. And if a man finally divorces his wife, he cannot remarry her until she has married another man. Then if the next husband divorces her, there will be no blame on either of them if the former husband and wife return to one another, provided they think that they can keep within the bounds set by God. These are the bounds prescribed by God, which he makes clear to men of understanding. Once you divorce women, and they have reached the end of their waiting period, then either retain them in all decency, or part from them decently. Do not retain them in order to harm them or wrong them. Whoever does this wrongs his own soul. Do not make a mockery of God's revelations. Remember the favors God has bestowed upon you, and the book and the wisdom he has revealed to exhort you. Fear God, and know that God is aware of everything. When you divorce women and they reach the end of their waiting period, do not prevent them from marrying other men, if they have come to an honorable agreement. This is enjoined on every one of you who believes in God and the last day. It is more wholesome and purer for you. God knows, but you do not know. And the divorced mothers should nurse their children for 2 whole years, if they wish to complete the period of nursing. And during that period, the father of the child shall be responsible for the maintenance of the mother in a reasonable manner. No soul is charged with more than it can bear. No mother should be made to suffer on account of her child, and no father should be made to suffer on account of his child. The same duties devolve upon the father's heir in case of the death of the father. But if after consultation they choose by mutual agreement to wean the child, there shall be no blame on them. Nor shall it be any offense for you if you desire to engage a wet nurse for your children, provided you hand over what you have agreed to pay in a reasonable manner. Have fear of God, and know that God is observant of all your actions. If any of you die and leave widows, the widows should wait for 4 months and 10 days. When they have reached the end of their waiting period, you will not be blamed for what they may reasonably choose to do with themselves. God is aware of what you do. It shall be no offense for you to hint at a proposal of marriage to divorced or widowed women, or to cherish them in your hearts. God knows that you will bear them in mind. But do not enter into any secret arrangement with them, beyond conveying some indication to them of your inclination. Do not proceed with tying their marriage knot before the end of their waiting period. Know that God has knowledge of all your thoughts. Therefore, take heed and bear in mind that God is forgiving and forbearing. You will not be blamed for not paying the dower money if you divorce women when you have not yet consummated the marriage or fixed a dower money upon them. But make fair provision for them, the affluent according to his means and the straitened according to his means. This is binding on righteous men. If you divorce them before the marriage is consummated, but after the dower money has been settled, give them the half of their dower money, unless they, the women, agree to forego it, or the man, the husband, in whose hand lies the marriage knot, forgoes it. To forego is nearer to righteousness. Do not neglect any chance of behaving benevolently towards each other. God is observant of whatever you do. Be ever mindful of prayers, especially the middle prayer, and stand up before God in submissive devotion. When you are exposed to danger, pray on foot or while riding. When you are safe again, remember God, for he has taught you what you did not know. If any of you die and leave widows, make a bequest for them for a year's maintenance without causing them to leave their homes. But if they leave of their own accord, you will not be blamed for what they may reasonably choose to do with themselves. God is almighty and wise. For divorced women, a provision according to what is fair shall also be made. This is an obligation binding on the righteous. Thus God makes his commandments clear to you so that you may understand. Have you not seen those who fled their homes in their thousands for fear of death? Whereupon God said to them, "Die," and later brought them back to life. Surely God is bountiful to mankind, but most of them are ungrateful. Fight in defense in God's cause, and remember that he is all-hearing and all-knowing. Who will give God a generous loan? He will multiply it many times over. It is God who withholds, and God who gives abundantly, and it is to him that you shall be all returned. Have you not heard of what the chiefs of the children of Israel demanded of one of their prophets after Moses? They said, "Appoint for us a king, and we will fight for the cause of God." He replied, What if he refused to fight when ordered to do so? Why should we not fight for the cause of God, they replied, when we have been driven forth from our homes and our children? But when at last they were commanded to fight, they all refused, except for a few of them. God knows the wrongdoers. Their prophet said to them, God has now appointed Talut to be your king. But they replied, how can he be king over us, when we are worthier of kingship than he, and he has not even been granted an abundance of wealth? He said, God has chosen him over you, and has given him great knowledge and physique. God grants kingship to whoever he pleases. God is magnanimous and all-knowing. Their prophet also said to them, the sign of his kingship is that the Ark of the Covenant shall come to you. Therein shall be tranquility from your Lord, and the relics which the house of Moses and the house of Aaron left behind. It will be borne by the angels. There is a sign in this for you, if you believe. When Talut set out with his forces, he said to them, God will test you with a river. Whoever drinks from it is not with me, and whoever does not drink is with me. There will, however, be no blame upon one who sips only a handful from it. But except for a few of them, they all drank from it. When he and those who believed along with him had crossed the river, they said, we have no strength today against Goliath and his warriors. But those of them who believed that they would meet God replied, many a small group by God's command has prevailed against a large group. God is indeed with the steadfast. When they met Goliath and his warriors, they said, our Lord, bestow patience upon us. Make us stand firm and help us against those who deny the truth. And so, by the command of God, they defeated them. David killed Goliath, and God gave him kingship and wisdom and imparted to him the knowledge of whatever he willed. Had it not been for God's repelling some people by means of others, the earth would have been filled with corruption, but God is bountiful to his creatures. These are the revelations of God which we recite to you in all truth, for you are truly one of the messengers. Of these messengers, we have given something additional among them. There are some to whom God spoke directly and others he exalted in rank. We gave Jesus, son of Mary, clear signs and strengthened him with the Holy Spirit. Had God pleased, those who succeeded them would not have fought against one another after the clear signs had come to them. But they disagreed among themselves. Some believed, while others did not. Yet had God willed, they would have not fought against one another. But God does whatever he wills. Believers, spend out of what we have given you, before the day comes when there will be neither trading, friendship, nor intercession. Truly, it is those who deny the truth who are the wrongdoers. God, there is no deity save him, the living, the eternal one. Neither slumber nor sleep overtakes him. To him belong whatever is in the heavens and whatsoever is on the earth. Who can intercede with him except by his permission? He knows all that is before them and all that is behind them. They can grasp only that part of his knowledge which he wills. His throne extends over the heavens and the earth, and their upholding does not weary him. He is the sublime, the Almighty One. There shall be no compulsion in religion. True guidance has become distinct from error. But whoever refuses to be led by Satan and believes in God has grasped the strong handhold that will never break. God is all-hearing and all-knowing. God is the patron of the faithful. He leads them from darkness to the light. As for those who deny the truth, their supporter is Satan, who brings them out of light into darkness. They are the heirs of the fire, and there they will remain forever. Have you not heard of him who argued with Abraham about his Lord, because God had bestowed the kingdom upon him? Abraham said, my Lord is the one who gives life and brings death. He answered, I too give life and bring death. Abraham said, God brings up the sun from the east, so bring it up yourself from the west. Then the disbeliever was confounded. God does not guide the wrongdoers. Or of him, when passing by a town the roofs of which had caved in, exclaimed, How will God restore it to life after its destruction? Thereupon God caused him to die, and after 100 years brought him back to life. God asked, How long have you remained in this state? He answered, I have remained a day or a part of a day. God said, No, you have remained in this state for 100 years. Now look at your food and your drink. They have not rotted. Look at your ass. We will make you a sign to mankind. Look at the bones, how we set them together, then clothe them with flesh. When it had all become clear to him, he said, Now I know that God has power over all things. When Abraham said, Show me, my Lord, how you revive the dead, God said, Do you not believe? Abraham answered, Yes, indeed I do believe, but just to reassure my heart. Then God said, Take 4 birds and train them to come back to you. Then place them separately on each hilltop and call them. They will come flying to you. Know that God is almighty and wise. Those who spend their wealth for God's cause may be compared to a grain of corn which sprouts into 7 ears, with 100 grains in each ear. For God grants manifold increase to whom he wills. God is infinite and all-knowing. Those who spend their wealth for God's cause and do not follow their almsgiving with taunts and insults shall be rewarded by their Lord. They will have no fear, nor shall they grieve. A kind word and forgiveness is better than a charitable deed followed by hurtful words. God is self-sufficient and forbearing. Believers, do not cancel out your charitable deeds with reminders and hurtful words, like one who spends his wealth only to be seen by people, and not believing in God and the last day. Such men are like a rock, covered with earth. A shower falls upon it, and it leaves it hard and bare. They will gain nothing from their works. God does not guide those who deny the truth. But those who spend their wealth in order to gain God's approval and to strengthen their souls are like a garden on elevated ground. When heavy rain falls on it, it doubles its produce. And if heavy rain does not fall, then light rain suffices. God sees what you do. Would any of you, being a man well advanced in age with helpless children to support, like to have a garden of dates and grapes watered by rivers and containing all kinds of fruits, stricken by a fiery whirlwind and utterly scorched? Thus God makes his signs clear to you, so that you may reflect. Believers, give charitably from the good things which you have earned and what we produce for you from the earth, not worthless things which you yourselves would only reluctantly accept. Know that God is self-sufficient and praiseworthy. Satan threatens you with the prospect of poverty and commands you to do foul deeds. But God promises his forgiveness and his bounty. God is bountiful and all-knowing. He grants wisdom to whom he will, and whoever is granted wisdom has indeed been granted abundant wealth. Yet none bear this in mind except those endowed with understanding. Whatever you spend, and whatever vows you make, are known to God. But the wrongdoers shall have no helpers. If you give charity openly, it is good. But if you keep it secret and give to the needy in private, that is better for you, and it will atone for some of your bad deeds. God is aware of all that you do. It is not your responsibility to make them follow the right path. God guides whomever he pleases. Whatever wealth you spend is to your own benefit, provided that you spend only to seek the favor of God. Whatever wealth you spend for God's cause shall be repaid to you in full, and you shall not be wronged. The needy, who are too engrossed in God's cause to be able to travel about the land in search of a livelihood, are considered by those who are unaware of their condition to be free from want, because they refrain from begging. But they can be known from their appearance. They do not make insistent demands upon people. Whatever wealth you spend, God knows it. Those who spend their wealth night and day, both privately and publicly, will receive their reward from their Lord. They shall have no fear, nor shall they grieve. Those who live on usury shall rise up before God like men who Satan has demented by his touch. For they say, buying and selling is only a kind of usury. But God has made trade lawful and made usury unlawful. Therefore, he who desists because of the admonition which has come to him from his Lord may retain what he has received in the past, and it will be for God to judge him. Those who revert to it shall be the inmates of the fire. They shall abide therein forever. God blights usury and blesses charitable deeds. God does not love the ungrateful wrongdoer. Those who believe, do good deeds, attend to their prayers, and engage in almsgiving shall be rewarded by their Lord and shall have no fear, nor shall they grieve. Believers, have fear of God and give up what is still due to you from usury, if you are true believers. For if you do not do so, then know that you are at war with God and his messenger. But if you repent, you may retain your capital. Do not wrong others, and you will not be wronged. If the debtor is in straitened circumstance, then grant him respite till a time of ease. If you were to write it off as an act of charity, that would be better for you, if you only knew. Fear the day when you shall be made to return to God. Then every soul shall be paid in full what it has earned, and they shall not be wronged. Believers, when you contract a debt for a stated term, put it down in writing. Have a scribe write it down with fairness between you. No scribe should refuse to write. Let him write as God has taught him. Let the debtor dictate, and let him fear God, his Lord, and not diminish the debt at all. If the debtor is weak in mind or body, or unable to dictate, then in fairness let his guardian dictate for him. Call in two of your men as witnesses. But if two men cannot be found, then call one man and two women out of those you approve of as witnesses, so that if one of the two women should forget, the other can remind her. Let the witnesses not refuse when they are summoned. Do not be disinclined to write down your debts, be they small or large, together with the date of payment. This is more just in the sight of God. It is more reliable as testimony and more likely to prevent doubts arising between you, unless it be ready merchandise which you give or take from hand to hand. Then it will not be held against you for not writing it down. Have witnesses present whenever you trade with one another, and let no harm be done to either scribe or witness, for if you did cause them harm, it would be a crime on your part. Be mindful of God. He teaches you. He has full knowledge of everything. If you are on a journey and do not find any literate person, something should be handed over as security. If one of you entrusts another with something, let the trustee restore the pledge to its owner, and let him fear God, his Lord. Do not conceal testimony. If someone does conceal it in his heart, he commits a crime. God knows what you do. All that the heavens and the earth contain belongs to God. Whether you disclose what is in your minds or keep it hidden, God will bring you to account for it. He will forgive whom he will and punish whom he pleases. He has power over all things. The messenger believes in what has been sent down to him from his Lord, and so do believers. They all believe in God and his angels, his scriptures, and his messengers. They say, we do not differentiate between any of his messengers. We hear and obey. Grant us your forgiveness, Lord. To you we shall all return. God does not charge a soul with more than it can bear. It shall be requited for whatever good and whatever evil it has done. They pray, our Lord, do not take us to task if we forget or make a mistake. O Lord, do not place on us a burden like the one you placed on those before us. O Lord, do not place on us a burden we have not the strength to bear. Pardon us and forgive us and have mercy on us. You are our Lord and sustainer. So help us against those who deny the truth. End of Surah Al-Baqarah.